COVID has kind of taken a run through our community, and so that's why many of us are wearing masks and finding ourselves distanced from one another physically, though not spiritually. And so as we gather this morning, I'm looking for prayers. So what prayers do you bring today? There are choir members, yes. Say that again?
Pat and Scott.
Pat and Scott.
Mike and Cooper.
Mike and Cooper. Any other prayers today?
Jason.
What other prayers do you bring today as we gather in God's name? We will carry these prayers with us through this time of worship, and I will carry them through our week as well. God's light shines before the first stars. It persists across millennia and continues to shine in us today. Like God's light, God's presence with creation has persisted throughout the slavery and wandering with kings and prophets, through Christ and with us. May God's light guide us, and may God's presence encourage us. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing our gathering music together. It's been a pretty hard week. Are there any celebrations today? I assume that you all don't have COVID because you're here, so yay! Celebrate life wherever you can, celebrate health wherever you can, and so I celebrate your presence here today, as well as those who are going to be watching this on YouTube through the week. Because we are taking a little bit of precautions today, there will be no coffee and conversation following worship today. I probably won't be shaking hands or offering hugs at the door, so please don't be offended. In 2 weeks, on November 5th, we will be having our hymn sing. So I encourage you to come a little bit early on that first Sunday of November as we sing our way into worship. Also on November 5th, we are going to be having our remembrance service. So if you have names to include in our honor roll, please get them to Judy sooner than later. Also on November 5th, daylight saving time ends. I don't hear any celebrations for the extra hour you're going to get in 2 weeks, because that's what's going to happen. So either set your clocks or come early, and then you'll be here in lots of time for the hymn singing. Because COVID has found its way into my home with my my daughter and my partner, my office hours this week may be affected. So please reach out to me by phone or by email and we'll arrange whatever we can. Last couple of announcements. Chili Takeout, that's going to be on November 3rd, and they're taking orders in the narthex in the entryway there following worship. Also, tickets for Laughing All the Way, which is taking place. It's kind of a comedy and music opportunity right here on November 30th, Thursday, November 30th. Tickets are available to be sold either there or we're actually inviting people to take tickets to sell them to the wider community so that we can get as many people in here on November 30th to celebrate as we make our way into Advent. Those are the announcements that I bring. Are there any others for the glory of God or the good of this community?
Youth next week.
Right.
The 29th. 6:30
here?
Is the Halloween party. And it's here.
Okay, so next Sunday, October 29th, the youth are gathering here at Nashwaaksis United at 6:30.
Yes.
Perfect. And it's a Halloween party. So share it with the youth in your lives. And if there are no other announcements, then I invite you to join with me responsibly as we call one another into this time of worship. God's presence is with us in this time and space.
God's presence is with us throughout the entirety of our lives.
May we sing with passion the songs of faith.
May we dance and dance the creation.
Guided by that presence, that spirit, may we pray and serve.
Guided by that presence, that spirit, our very lives become an act of worship.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, your voice has called us together and continuously calls us along life's way. Send your spirit into this time, into your people, and fill us with a passion for the faith that we have found in your Son and our brother Jesus Christ. Make us bold proclaimers and sharers of your love and grace in all that we do. Remind us in the holy stories that we read that you are the ruler in our hearts, our partner in creation, our companion on the way. We offer this and all our prayers in the strong name of Jesus Christ, our friend and our guide. Amen. And now I'm going to invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we join our voices in singing, Here I Am, Lord. That's Voices United 509.
I am well.
I invite you to join with me as we offer together our prayer of confession. Let us pray. We admit, O God, that we don't always know what you are looking for. Your scriptures and your Son have taught us so much, but often we choose to go our own way, walk our own path. Forgive us when we offer endless words when silence would do. Forgive us when we think that strength is of more value than vulnerability. Forgive us when we stand still, when your song of creation calls us to dance. Help us to see with your eyes, to embrace with your love, to dance with joy when your spirit moves in us. Forgive us, transform us, help us to grow in you. This we pray in the name of Christ, our eternal dance partner. Amen. The good news for us is that God's song never ends. We can always join in the dance of creation and of celebration of God's presence. Even when we think we aren't the voices that God needs or the dancers that God wants, the Spirit calls us, one and all. Amen. And now, as we reflect on the faith that we have found in Christ with one another, let us stand in body or in spirit as we offer together a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the Church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our Judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Now, because our choir has been diminished, we are going to forego our music ministry for today, and so I'm going to invite Debbie forward to offer our scripture readings.
Reading this morning from Mark 11, 8-10. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Our second reading is from 2 Samuel 5, 1-5, 6, 1-5. Then all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "Look, we are your bone and flesh. For some time, while Saul was king over us, it was you who led out Israel and brought it in. The Lord said to you, 'It is you who shall be shepherd of my people Israel, you who shall be ruler over Israel.' So all the leaders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord. And they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned for 40 years. At Hebron he reigned over Judah for 7 years and 6 months, and at Jerusalem he reigned over all of Israel and Judah for 33 years. David again gathered all the men of Israel, 30,000. David and all the people with him set out and went from Baal-Judah to bring up from there the Ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who is enthroned on the cherubim. They carried the Ark of God on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadad, which was on the hill. Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadad, were driving the new cart with the ark of God, and Ahio went in front of the ark. David and all the house of Israel were dancing before the Lord with all their might, with songs and lyrics and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. The last reading is from Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise God in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his surpassing greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with clanging cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Debbie. So I asked you at the start of the service just a few minutes ago, what do you have to celebrate today? So what do you have to celebrate? Other than being able to be here and being relatively healthy and that kind of thing, what are you celebrating today?
The country we live in.
The country we live in, sure. What else?
My family.
Your family? What else?
Friends?
There's got to be more to celebrate than that.
Good health.
Good health, relative good health, right?
A good hockey game for my granddaughter last night.
A good hockey game for your granddaughter, that's great. Not great for the other team, maybe, but... What else? What was that one? I heard a good one. Was that the presence of God? Ah, that's a good one. These are all good ones. But all of our readings today have to do with celebration. Whether it's Christ riding into town on a donkey, people are celebrating. Whether it is David being crowned the new king and people are celebrating. Whether it is in the psalm, which is a reflection of that time when David and the people are dancing, and they're dancing and singing and praising God. Because there is so much to celebrate. And we say that we have all of these things to celebrate, our friends, our family, our good health, a hockey game. But all of that is saturated by the holy presence of God. Every moment of our lives is touched by God's Holy Spirit. That makes even the ordinary moments, the ones, the hard to wake up mornings, the times where you're awake late at night and you can't get to sleep, it makes those moments holy. It makes the ordinary extra. And so that's worth celebrating. And that's why the psalm calls us to celebrate, calls us to praise God with not just the instruments that we can find, but with our very bodies, our very souls, to celebrate the God that has given us so much. The God that calls us out into the world, that wakes us in the morning, that watches over us at night. There is so much to celebrate, even in a world that seems so filled with darkness. Look at that first reading that we had from the Gospel of Mark. They were celebrating that Christ was with them, that God was with them, yes! But they were being occupied by Rome. That was a hard time for them. But they celebrated because God was with them. So even in those hardest moments of our lives, we can lift our songs and prayers of praise to the one who is continually by our side along life's way. So before we move into our next hymn, I know there's no youth with us today, but we're all young at heart, right?
Right.
Right. Let's pray together. Dear God,
help us, your children,
to feel your presence,
to feel your presence
in every day,
in every hour,
in
In every minute.
In every minute.
In every breath.
In every breath.
You make us holy.
You make us holy.
As we celebrate you.
As we celebrate you.
In Christ's name we pray.
In Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
And now I'm going to invite you to lift your voices as we rise in body or in spirit and sing How Firm a Foundation. Voices United 660.
He does stand out as one of the great kings of Israel.
The first king over Israel was a man named Saul. He was the first king that God had chosen. And to be fair to Saul, he was the king that anyone might have chosen, any of us might have chosen. He was a military leader, and he had many victories under his belt. He was described as a handsome man, a strategist. He seemed to have all of the qualities that one might look for in a king. And he was a flawed man, like any of us. But more than that, he let being king go to his head. He became prideful. He followed in his own way rather than the way that God was calling him to. And so King Saul, who as a general had victory after victory, was surrounded by failure in his efforts to follow God. Now that's a very shallow and maybe unfair overview of Saul's reign. But it's important to glimpse this before we look at David. Because David was unlike Saul in so many ways. Saul was a military leader when God chose him. David was a shepherd, not a leader of men, but a leader of sheep. Saul was a grown man when God chose him, while David was still a young boy. Saul's reign was scarred with pride, with fear, with disobedience to God's word, and David's reign, though very much not perfect, is remembered as one of the greatest in Israel's history. The thing is that God never really wanted a king for Israel. Because God is the one who's supposed to be king in our hearts, right? What more could people want? But the people of Israel looked around at other nations with kings and they cried out to God, "We want a king too." To which God answered, "Sure, but I'll choose." And God did choose. For that first king, God chose how we might choose, based on status, military victories. Because when the people cried out for a king, they wanted a mighty king, a powerful king, who would lead their armies to more victories. And while Saul may have looked good on paper, he ended up letting that role go to his head. He forgot that it was God who called him to that role, and more often than not, he went his own way, much to his own detriment. And so God set about to choose again. But this time, God wouldn't be looking at potential kings through the eyes of the people for what they might want. Instead, God looked deeper to see the qualities and the gifts that aren't readily apparent, but that are just what the people of Israel needed in a king. Rather than choose from some high-born family, God chose the youngest of 8 sons of a family in the country. Rather than choose a general, God chose a shepherd, because more than victories, God knew that the people of Israel needed someone to care for them. The people of Israel needed someone to guide them. Now, the point of this little history lesson is to remind us that when God chooses someone, there's usually a good reason. And sometimes it isn't always clear. God chose Saul because that's who the people would choose, because that's who the people thought they wanted. God chose David because in David, God saw the kind of king that the people needed. Was David flawed? Yes. Did he make mistakes and sometimes anger God? Yes, absolutely. But God wasn't looking for flawless. God wasn't looking for perfect. God was looking for the king that the broken people needed. The breaking of the mold of a king is carried forward to one of our other readings for today, where Jesus rides into Jerusalem. The people of Jesus' own day were calling out for a Messiah, but like the people centuries before who called out for a king, They wanted a powerful general, a charismatic leader, someone who would drive out the Romans and make Israel great again. But they didn't get what they wanted. They didn't get what they expected. Instead, they got a carpenter's son. And he didn't ride into town on a war horse surrounded by legions of warriors. He rode into town on a donkey, cheered on by the lowest and the least. And Jesus wasn't there to drive out the Romans. He came to bring the people home to their faith, a faith that was meant to reach out to the margins, not push people to them. God sees in us things that we often don't even see ourselves. God sees our gifts, and by the movement of the Spirit and the grace of Christ, those gifts and strengths are drawn out so that we might support one another, that we might stand with our kindred, that we might build one another up. God also sees what we need. And rather than respond to our expectations and send us exactly what we think we want, God peppers our lives with friends, with neighbors, with family, with strangers along the way to guide us through. And through all of this, whether it is to kings or priests, prophets or messiahs, you or me, God is eternally present, embracing us, encouraging us, calling out to us along life's way. But there's two sides to these readings. One is definitely the acknowledgement of God's chosen, even giving us a glimpse into how God chooses us. But there's something else going on in these readings, something that's even more obvious and shown in the actions of the people. Does anybody know what it is? We were talking about it not long ago. Celebration! Well, right. We were talking about it just a minute ago. Celebration, praise, worship. We see all of these in the way the people welcome Christ. We see them in the way King David and the people dance and sing and pray their way before the Ark of God. And we hear them in the Psalms urging of the people to praise God in every moment, in every part of their lives. But they aren't just celebrating that they have been chosen in one way or another, or celebrating just because they are a part of God's work in the world. All of this praise is because God is so present with the people. In the gospel reading, God is present in Christ as he rides into town. In the reading from Samuel, God is present in the ark. And in the psalm, that holy presence is blanketed across the world, across the parts of all of the people's lives. That's something worth celebrating. Yes, we should give praise and thanks to God for the many partners that we find along life's way as we work together to build the kingdom. Yes, we should praise and give thanks to God for the unique gifts that each one of us possesses, gifts that God calls on us to use to serve our neighbors and build a better tomorrow. And yes, we should praise and give thanks to God for the ways that we are chosen to transform this world, even if it's only in a small way, and even when we only answer that call reluctantly. But one of the simplest and greatest gifts that we have in this life is that God's presence is eternally with us. More than a Messiah on a donkey or a holy presence in a sacred ark, God is with us in our every moment. God is with us in our waking and our sleeping, in our wondering and our wandering, when we succeed and when we fail. God is with us, supporting us, guiding us, laughing and crying with us. I get why David and the whole house of Israel were dancing and singing. I get why the psalm is so alive with praise. I get why the people so eagerly welcome and celebrate Christ. Knowing that God is that present in our lives, in our every moment, makes every moment, even the ordinary ones, even the awful ones. It makes all of our moments a sacred part of our journey to who we are today and who we can be in service to God. None of that is to say that our worst moments aren't still painful, that our losses don't diminish us, because they do, and they are. But we aren't alone in the pain or the loss any more than we are alone in our joys or our triumphs. That's what the people are celebrating. The people in the time of Christ who are under the occupation of Rome are celebrating because God is with them. When the time came for the crowning of a new king, the people celebrated because God was with them, and we should be celebrating too. We should be celebrating with song, with prayer, with dance, with our whole being, because throughout our lives, God is with us. So as we prepare to move from praise, from learning, from worship to lives of service, may we be attentive to what we have found in the exploration of the word today. That in us God sees a potential that we might never have imagined. And that God is calling to us, choosing us to live into that potential. And as we strive along the way through our trials and our triumphs, may we ever be mindful of God's presence along that way. And through it all, let us celebrate. Let us lift our thanks and praise for the gift that we have been given, and let us dance and sing because God journeys with us. Let us pray. We praise you, O God of life, because in all of life, throughout all of creation, your holy presence can be felt. Within each of us, your divine spark shines. And by the Spirit's encouragement, we are kindled into flames of passion, of faith, and of service. Work in and through us, we pray. Amen. And now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing together, Come Touch Our Hearts, More Voices, number 12.
for our mission and service story for today.
Our mission and service story today is titled Building Climate Resiliency. In areas where historically there has been little rain, now there are floods. And where there are floods, now there are droughts. That's how Chandrik Chemba, the Monitoring and Evolution Manager at Women for Change, an organization in Zambia that strives to improve conditions in rural communities by empowering women and girls, describes the changing climate in Zambia. Women bear the brunt. In Zambia, women are still responsible for collecting firewood and charcoal and making food. Now, because of climate change, they have to walk longer distances to gather firewood. Charcoal is harder to get. That means it's harder to make food. At the same time, women aren't involved in the decision-making process that impact this work, explains Chemba. Women for Change was established in 1992, and its long-standing partnership with the United Church stretches back to 1995. From the beginning, mobilizing communities to share ideas and best practices has been key to the work. Since its inception, 1,500 community groups have been established, with 25 to 40 people in each group and representatives from each farming association. The groups discuss a variety of justice-related topics, building climate resiliency by preparing for, recovering from, and adapting to drastically changing weather patterns is a priority. Weather extremes due to climate change, coupled with companies promoting seeds that only produce a single crop, increasingly put people at risk. The majority of farmers are poor. They can't buy seeds, but companies have created seeds that force farmers to have to purchase them each year, said Chemba. Groups discuss how they can save and share seeds, what they can plant with longer or shorter rains, and if there are traditional methods that can increase food production, he says, adding, we are grateful for the United Church's support. The church has really been there for many years, helping us build awareness and resiliency. It's been a real partnership. Your gifts through mission and service support long-term, life-changing work through committed partners like Women for Change. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie. The Mission and Service Fund is just one of the many ways that we are a part of change in the world. But I also want to give thanks for the many gifts that are offered right here in this community as we work towards wholeness together. And now let us seek God's blessing on all that we do and all that we bring. Let's sing together our dedication verse, and I invite you to remain seated. Christ, our brother. Amen.
as we celebrate God's gifts to us and presence with us. Let us lift our prayers of thanks and concern for ourselves, for our community. Let us pray. You are with us, O God. You are with us in this time that we make holy by gathering in your name. You are with us in our singing, our praying, our hearing of your word. You are with us here, but we also know that you are with us when we rise in the morning to greet the day, that you watch over us in our sleep. You walked with us through the week, embracing us in the midst of our struggles, lifting us up in our joys. You are so constantly with us that our lives are saturated by your holy presence. May we always be sensitive to that presence, to the movements of your Spirit in our lives, to the proddings of Christ along life's way. Remind us that more than this hour, our whole lives are made holy because of our intimate connection to you, to one another, and to creation. Hear us this day, O God, as we lift our prayers and praise. We give thanks, O generous one, for the many gifts that you have poured into our lives. We give thanks for this day, this hour, this minute, the very breath that we breathe. We give thanks for the part that each plays in the forming of a new creation. We give thanks for the unique strengths that you have given each of us, a reminder that we are not meant to stand alone, but to complement one another in our strengths and our weaknesses. We give thanks for the turning of the seasons, a reminder that our world mirrors our faith as we move from life into death and back into new life. Guide us through this cycle and remind us that every day we are a new creation in you. For these and for so many other blessings, we give you thanks. Hear us this day, O God, as we lift our prayer and our praise. We pray, O shepherding God, for our world. Near and far, your people need healing, hope, renewal, and love. Especially today, we pray for our kindred locked in conflict around this world. We pray for innocent lives lost when violence becomes the default answer. We pray for our kindred on both sides whose lives have been forever scarred by war. Closer to home, we feel the days getting colder as nights lengthen. Encourage us to open our hearts and minds as we seek a way forward together. We also pray for our kindred who have been wrestling with illness, especially those who have been sick with COVID this past week. Help us to be mindful of one another, aware of each other's health and safety. Remind us that we are entering a season where sicknesses of all kinds are making the rounds, and that the most vulnerable among us are at risk. Keep us safe. Keep us healthy, we pray. Especially today, we lift our prayers for those people and situations closest to our hearts. Hear them as we offer them to you in word and in silence. We pray this day for our kindred in Israel and Palestine. We pray, O God, for our kindred in Ukraine and Russia. Pray for your people around this world who struggle with poverty. And pray for those close to home who aren't sure where their next warm night will be. We pray for members of this community who have been brought low by COVID. We ask that you continue to guide us as we care for one another. We pray, O God, for Pat and Scott. We pray for Mike and Cooper. Pray, O God, for Jason. I offer special prayers for my own family as we wrestle with the loss of my aunt, and for my partner and daughter as they struggle with COVID. Hear us this day, O God, as we lift our prayers and our praise. Lastly, we pray for ourselves. You know, O God of all life, what we need. Sometimes you know better than we do. But still, we pray today for your strength in those times where we are weak. We pray for your courage when fear overtakes us, when fear starts to make our decisions for us. We pray for your wisdom when the path before us seems uncertain. Encourage, inspire, empower us. Hear us this day, O God, as we lift our prayers and our praise. These are the prayers of your people, O God. We offer them to you, bound up in the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn today is in Voices United 579, and I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing together, The Church is Wherever God's People Are Praising. Peace of Christ in your hands and with the power of the Holy Spirit at your backs.
to share the good news you've heard this day. Amen.
Amen.
And now I invite you to join with me as we sing our closing music, Peace Be With You.